Well, how can I know anything is true anymore?
From now on, I think we need to flip the default. Everyone should be, you know, assumed to be a bot, unless we are meeting face to face, as we're meeting now.
The PC evolves to become the AI PC. Mm-hmm. Then, is that like the end of OpenAI? Hey, Audrey, great to be able to chat with you. I was just thinking you've got so many technical accomplishments. I think probably the topic of the year has got to be AI. What do you think of AI? We're here now. It's here now.
Very much so. I often think of AI as assistive intelligence. That is to say, something that helps people communicate. Of course, I use language models all the time. I, on my own MacBook, train an email replying language model that learns from everything that I have ever written so that I can draft my emails. I can just say, you know, decline very politely, and then it replies in a very polite way, in a way that I would do it. Because it's trained on my laptop, I don't have to worry about privacy, security, or things like that.
Yeah, in that case, it really is an agent completely on your behalf. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think most of the world is still using an agent that's somewhere in the cloud or, you know, far away from them. Mm-hmm. But in your case, you've kind of just put it right on your computer.
Yeah.
I'm thinking that that's probably what's going to happen for everybody in future. I think AI is a little bit of a suit of armor that, you know, you may need it to protect yourself, like assist you as in writing the email, but also all these things that come in that are maybe not so helpful to you could be watching over and guiding.
I think personal computing means that we are still the person and the AI just assists or augments our capabilities.
Yeah, and I mean, the whole thing is pretty fascinating. I mean, mm-hmm. like a lot has happened in, you know, 5 years, and a big surprise last year with OpenAI and, mm-hmm. you know, GPTs and the language models. But I think of it sometimes kind of like there's a library of all the work on the internet, and somehow it's all sucked into some billion number of parameters. Mm-hmm. And now instead of reading any of them, you can just ask this little translator. It's like a librarian for the internet. And instead of telling you it's on aisle 12, which is what Google would do, it just says, oh, the paragraph you want to know about basically says this.
And it can interpolate between very polite, somewhat polite, and somewhat not polite as well.
In its response.
Yes. So I'm very interested in this idea of alignment, tuning the AI models to the local expectations, because what's considered normal in Silicon Valley or wherever it's trained may not be normal in my culture or in the way that I write emails. So how to steer it or to align it is also something that's very interesting.
I think the amazing thing there is that that same one AI model can be all personalities. It's like you could imagine a version where all these AI models are trained differently. You know, like this one is supposed to sound like a Western cowboy, and this other one is supposed to be like very empathetic or something. But the same AI model can just, you can just ask it for a slice of its personality.
Right, it's like a foundation model. It can evolve into yeah. various different personalities.
I mean, it can literally like, it can say, tell it to me like a therapist would, and it'll tell it to you like that. The same one will just give you all these different variations.
Because for the past 8 years, during my tenure in public service, I published all the transcripts of the journalistic interviews and even some internal meetings online. Yeah. So if you ask any foundation model, you know, phrase it in a way that Audrey Tang would. Actually, it already knows how Audrey Tang sounds like.
Let's say we go to that future where everyone's got their AI mm-hmm. embedded in their computer,
personal
in their phone, or,
right.
you know.
AI PC or
yeah,
something.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. PC evolves to become mm-hmm. the AI PC. Mm-hmm. Then is that like the end of OpenAI? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, now, you know, everyone's got their own. You don't really have to use that API or pay that monthly fee. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, in the beginning, before the personal computer, there was mainframe. And mainframe was very useful for a while, right?
Yeah.
And that was before, you know, VisiCalc or some of those killer applications that works on the personal level. So I fully expect there is still going to be a year or two for the cloud-based service to be very useful, mostly
sure.
because of network effect. But more or less, I think within a few years, the AI PC idea will catch up.
It's a pretty interesting thing from a strategy point of view from those companies, right? Because they are kind of going down one roadmap. And I'm assuming the one, you're probably using like Meta's version, I'm guessing.
Llama 3.
Yeah, yes. Right. Mm-hmm. So that one is open source, kind of going with your philosophy mm-hmm. on a number of things, right? Mm-hmm. So if everyone's got an open source and Meta doesn't charge for it, and you know that's widely everywhere, mm-hmm. Maybe those gigantic stock prices are not warranted for all the companies that are, you know, getting in there. What does that mean for misinformation or for the, you know, possible harm that happens to truth because of AI?
There's currently nothing preventing anyone from taking Llama 3 and tune it on Audrey Tang's, you know, way of speech,
right,
or taking Stable Diffusion or taking Stable Video or any of those models and make a very convincing interactive deepfake at that people cannot really tell whether it's Audrey Tang speaking or not.
Yeah.
Whereas with the API, at least they can do some safeguarding.
I am not Morgan Freeman, and what you see is not real. Well, at least in contemporary terms, it is not. What if I were to tell you that I am not even a human being?
You just went into kind of open the door to, well, how can I know anything is true anymore? Mm-hmm. I mean, it seems like we were having a hard enough time just with social media, and frankly, the Google democratized algorithms for, you know, looking at, you know, when you type something in and where PageRank shows it to you, mm-hmm. it's not based on whether it's true, it's based on whether it's more popular.
It's a popularity contest.
Right, it's popularity contest mm-hmm. for truth. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we were already that far along. Mm-hmm. Now it's going to be even more hard to know mm-hmm. when something is true or not true. Mm-hmm. What happens?
Yeah, in Taiwan, we've seen a surge in scam, in fraud cases,
right?
Where you just see an advertisement on Google, YouTube, or on Meta, and so on, that says, this celebrity want to teach you on how to invest in stocks or whatever. And when you click it, it brings you to an end-to-end encrypted chat, like WhatsApp or something. And actually, that celebrity, in their sound, actually responds to your questions in real
right.
time. So it's very difficult for people to tell whether this is actually the celebrity or not. So our way to tackle this is very simply to say, you know, nowadays for investment advices or advertisements, assume for all advertisements, a digital signature need to be carried by the platform. If the platform does not carry the digital signature of the celebrity, and if somebody get conned for 1 million, say Facebook, from Facebook, and Facebook after getting notified of it didn't take it down, then Facebook will be liable for that 1 million of damage. This is re-internalizing the externalities.
All right, so what you're doing is you're basically taking the same approach that you use to know that when you go to www.x.com,
right.
that, you know, that same digital signature is mm-hmm. also to know that you're actually the, you know, talking mm-hmm. to the exact person.
Right, this is the KYC, right? Know your client
approach. Yeah, right, exactly. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm just thinking back to that, like, Taylor Swift, you know, mm-hmm. Thing, and like everybody can now make pictures of everybody and voices everyone. You don't know where the information's coming from and you don't care where it's coming from, but when it's mm-hmm. flooded over the internet, it's really affecting people. Mm-hmm. What about those situations?
Yeah, for example, leading up to elections,
yeah.
if some candidates or a minister or somebody gets deepfaked or even cheapfaked, right? Just, you know, getting some clips and remakes in a way that's not very creative, but convince people, right?
Right.
And then I think the most effective way we found to counter that is called pre-bunking, because to debunk is already after the fact. It's not going to catch up to the rumors and disinformation. But if we pre-bunk, for example, 2 years ago, I deepfaked myself and sent out a video, a government advertisement, really, that shows how an actor can play me and with just 12 hours of a MacBook processing becomes very convincing. And I tell people in that deepfake video, soon it will not be 12 hours. It will be 12 minutes and then 12 seconds and 12 milliseconds. And when it becomes 12 milliseconds, it becomes interactive and you cannot tell the difference anymore. So know that if it is not signed, if it doesn't come from a government number, because in Taiwan, all the government SMS come from a single number, 111. If it doesn't come from that number, then it's fake. Previously on the internet, if we see somebody's video or if you make a video call, the default is that we assume they're a human until they show bot-like behavior. And then we're like, child as a bot, right? But from now on, I think we need to flip the default. Everyone should be, you know, assumed to be a bot, unless we are meeting face to face, as we're meeting now. But otherwise, unless it's digitally signed, or your web of trust, meaning that people you already trust are human, vouch for that person, otherwise we should just assume it's a bot.
I think this idea of, do you know who is sending you information, mm-hmm. and how do we really know, and maybe we should just be assuming it's not them, mm-hmm. until there's a better way, or there's at least a way to mm-hmm. know it truly is that person. I guess that's the world we're really going into, and mm-hmm. this little conversation sheds a little light on what we can expect in future.
Yeah, very much so. I think digital signature, far from being something that people only use for e-commerce, is probably just going to be the default from this point on.
Very good. All right, thank you so much for taking the time.
Thank you.